He returned to his unit in time for their final attack to clear Holland of the last of its German occupiers.
Baby, broken bag, baby, I'm going home.
Your bag is done.
I'm going home.
Bro,
I'm
how you recover from a back, head, shoulders, knees, back? Like, how you good?
I'm going home.
Two broken ankles?
Chapped. That's too much.
What's good, y'all? It's the Dumachettes, Rhea, and we're back with another video. Who we got today, C?
Today, we're back with another American reaction. Yes. Super excited about this video. If you're new to us,
so and we're new to you,
make sure you scroll down,
hit that subscribe button,
and turn on the post notification bell,
because we're on the road to 200K.
And we cannot get there without you guys, all right? Join the family. Without further ado, let's get into the video.
Leo Major, the one-eyed scout who liberated a whole town. By himself.
With one eye.
World War II.
By himself.
In World War II, for the Canadian effort, one soldier stands out from all the rest. Leo Major. He was a French-Canadian from Montreal, Canada. In 1940, at the age of 19, he joined the Le Régiment de la Chaudière of the Canadian Army. Their insignia underlines their fierce fighting reputation, consisting of two crossed Vickers machine guns with a beaver above supporting fleur-de-lis. Private Leo Major first saw action at D-Day in France, taking part in the Normandy landings on June 6, 1944. Straight away, he distinguished himself as a scout behind enemy lines by capturing the German communications half-track full of secret code books.
Wow.
He then forced the captured crew to drive the Hanomag towards friendly lines, but was fired upon with anti-tank guns by British and Canadian troops. Leo had to climb on top of the vehicle to get them to stop firing as they drove closer, and later remarked how happy he was that the British and Canadian soldiers didn't know how to shoot. When the English officer asked Leo to hand over the Hanomag, Leo refused outright, stating that it was a Quebec man who captured it, and so it was handed over to the Chaudière Regiment. His war was nearly cut short when a few days later, he was scouting ahead of his unit. Leo unexpectedly encountered a patrolling elite Waffen-SS unit. In the ensuing firefight, he managed to kill four of the enemy soldiers, but one of them, fatally wounded, managed to throw a phosphorus grenade, and Leo was hit, damaging his left eye badly. Leo was then sent to a field hospital for treatment. Leo had to wear an eye patch while his eye healed, and he remarked on how he looked like a...
Leo, what was you doing?
He said he was trying to see something.
Right, basically. I mean, you just want to head on, like, into five.
Yes.
Good moves, though.
Yes, but I mean, that acid?
Cost your eye.
That's something that I, that's one act that, like, frightens me.
Yeah, getting hit with acid.
Yeah.
That hit different. It does.
Because there's some evil people in this world.
You can't get nothing back with that one. That's acid. Not even an eye.
Pirate. Remarkably, he refused to be sent home, stating that he only needed one good eye to aim a rifle.
Oh, God.
Quickly, he returned to the front line and continued to act as a scout and sniper for his unit. Shortly after returning to active service in October 1944, he was involved in the month-long Battle of the Scheldt in Holland, which involved much heavy fighting and several amphibious landings. One day during this prolonged battle, Leo's commanding officer had ordered him to find the 50 zombies who had gone missing on patrol earlier. Zombie was a slang term used by Canadian volunteers for unenthusiastic, inexperienced Canadian conscripts in the war. Leo was carrying out the reconnaissance by himself, as always wearing PT sneakers instead of heavy boots. He was deep behind enemy lines.
Why he got to wear running shoes? And everybody else has to wear boots. Now, you
maybe
can still run and move, maybe, you know what I'm saying? But, I mean, the sound?
I don't know. So far, something about him just different. And don't take that phrase that I said, he trying to see something the wrong way. That's a phrase, okay?
Right. And that was before he lost his eye, so it couldn't be funny.
Yeah, wasn't trying to be funny.
Yeah. I'm laughing on the inside.
Don't. Don't. Because I thought about it and I'm like, somebody's going to take that wrong.
They could.
Because that's just our lingo. But
yeah, that's that one literal person out there that'd be like, wow. No, she didn't. I can't believe she joking like that today.
I wasn't joking.
She wasn't, y'all. It was me. Blame me. Because I actually made it sound like the way it sounded. She was actually trying to get y'all to be clear with y'all thoughts.
Yes, be clear.
That's it. Okay.
Old Rain, muttering to himself. I am frozen and wet because of you, so you will pay. Drenched to the skin while not finding the zombies, did come across a garrison of German regular troops sleeping in trenches that they had been digging all day. Noticing a snoring German officer, Leo woke him up, pointing his Sten gun at him, and then motioned him to order his men to follow him. One soldier raised his rifle and was shot dead by Leo, followed by three others who joined the firefight. After this, he shouted, Achtung and Handenhoch, and the garrison quickly decided to surrender to him.
You know he's serious. Look how he's holding his gun.
Nah, babe, you know this anime.
So? They hold their guns like that for the size, like them big old long clips with the...
Yeah, but look at shoes.
I seen that. Somebody still got to explain to me, because this is my first time in all history of history hearing somebody just pulling a pair of shoes.
He wasn't supposed to stumble upon him.
Now this storyline right here is crazy.
Yeah.
This is crazy.
He then single-handedly marched 93 German soldiers back to the Allied lines. But on the way there, they were attacked by Waffen-SS troops manning an artillery battery from a neighboring village who were infuriated that their fellow countrymen were surrendering. This left a lasting impression on Leo. The Waffen-SS unit managed to kill and injure a number of the German prisoners before being driven off by an Allied Sherman tank. Leo then handed over 93 German prisoners to his speechless commander. For his act of bravery, Leo was awarded the Distinguished Conduct Medal, which is the second highest award in the British and Commonwealth, the Victoria Cross being the only one higher. But surprisingly, he declined the medal, feeling the British commander, General Montgomery, who was going to present him with the award, was incompetent and therefore in no position to give him that medal.
Oh, he cocked.
Then in February 1945, as his unit was fighting in the Rhineland in Germany, the Bren gun carrier he was traveling in hit a mine, wrecking the vehicle and killing all its occupants, except Leo. He was severely injured, including two badly broken ankles, four ribs, and his back in three places. Leo again refused to be shipped back home, and after a short spell in a Belgian hospital, he returned to his unit in time for their final attack to clear Holland of the last of its German occupiers.
Baby, broken back, baby, I'm going home.
Your bag is done.
I'm going home.
Bro, how you recover from a back, head, shoulders, knees, back? Like, how you good?
I'm going home.
Two broken ankles?
Chopped. That's so much. He loved his country.
And he refused the medal? All for that to happen?
Because he said the person was incompetent.
So, on April 13th, 1945, the Allies were preparing to attack the large Dutch town of Zwolle, but were unsure of the strength or deployment of the German forces in the town. That evening, Leo and his friend Corporal Willie Arsenault volunteered to carry out a recon of the area. The city was planned to be bombed by Allied artillery, and this is something Leo and Willie wanted to prevent. When the two approached the outskirts of the silent town, the Germans spotted Willie after his grenade bag made a rattling noise, and he was killed by enemy machine gun fire. Leo took two of them out, but the others fled in a vehicle. He then took his friend's Sten gun, an extra bag of grenades, then laid his lifeless body on the side. So enraged was Leo that he would go on a one-man rampage that lasted the whole night, using his submachine gun and bags full of grenades. He hijacked a nearby German scout car, disarming the driver and taking his MP40, adding a third submachine gun to his inventory. Leo made him drive to a hotel, then entered a bar. There, he disarmed a German officer who could speak French to Leo, and he made him aware that the town was to be bombed by Canadian artillery, which would result in German military and civilian casualties. The officer understood, and in good faith, Leo handed him back his pistol, allowing him to drive off in the hopes that he would evacuate his troops rather than rally an attack. Leo moved around the town for a few hours in the dead of night, firing on any German units he came up against, throwing grenades and making as much noise around town as possible.
Hold on, I thought he was trying to tell the Germans that the Canadians was coming to bomb them.
Yeah, but he spared that one man and his people.
I'm scratching my head.
But he said, I'm giving you one thing. I lost my thought. I'm giving you one chance and one chance only. Get out.
Basically.
That's it.
Basically.
I'm about to tear it up. Child, he mad. He saw his friend passing.
Yeah,
him.
That's what it was. Triggered him. Mm. Yeah, that'll do it to you.
His idea was to confuse the enemy into believing that they were under attack by a far larger Allied force storming the city. He proceeded in killing or capturing German defenders as he moved from street to street, using the local river and church as reference points so as not to get lost. Every time he had enough prisoners, normally between 8 to 10, he would march them back to the Allied lines and drop them off before returning to the town to carry on his one-man assault. He is reckoned to have done this around 10 times. 4 times in the night, he had to force his way into civilian houses to rest. Although terrified by his initial appearance, once they understood he was Canadian, they looked after Leo. During his rampage, he also attacked and set light to the Gestapo headquarters, further adding to the confusion. Then, finding the SS headquarters, he engaged in a firefight, killing 4 SS officers inside. Then, later, Leo came across a group of townsmen by chance. This included a local policeman by the name of Frit Kuiper. All of these men were secretly members of the Dutch resistance. Leo then explained to them that the town was liberated. Then the group went on to take the town hall and bring the civilians out onto the streets. By 4:30 a.m., the German garrison had fled the town, and Leo had single-handedly liberated Zwolle. Leo retrieved his friend Willy Arsenal's body and returned to his unit, who had yet to advance into the town. On that morning of April 14th, the Allied forces entered the town without a shot being fired and without the loss of...
Bro, he take going to work on time a little too serious. You know how they say, be the first one here?
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? So get the day started and be the last to leave. Man, he say, I'm going to just go ahead and get my job started.
Yeah, he did things as he wanted to in them shoes.
Yeah. Shout out to those shoes, man. Mm-hmm. Them sneakers, man.
Million life from the planned bombardment. Due to Leo's outstanding bravery the previous night. For his heroism above and beyond the call of duty, he was again awarded the Distinguished Conduct Medal, and this time he accepted it. After the war, Leo left the army and returned to civilian life to resume his old job as a pipe fitter. With the start of the Korean War in 1950, the Canadian Army joined the United Nations forces in fighting the Communist Chinese and North Korean invasion of South Korea. Leo, though only 29 years old, was seen as a veteran with a special skill set and was recruited to rejoin the Army and...
How old was he before?
Well, he joined when he was 19. So his 20s, he cut up.
Cut up for real. Oh, that shows the bravery.
Yeah.
Because when you're young, you don't be thinking about what could happen, what shouldn't happen. You just do it.
Unless it was in his family already.
Yeah.
And he was already wired that way.
Yeah. Confidence.
Confidence, yeah.
And bravery.
Mm-hmm.
Become a member of a special scout and sniper team. Then in November 1951, the communists attempted to take some strategic important high ground just 40 miles away from Seoul, the South Korean capital. The fighting was based around the vitally important Hill 355, nicknamed Little Gibraltar, and Hill 277. Chinese troops had captured it from the Americans, and Leo was to recapture and hold the hill. The fighting raged for days, and the Canadian commander, Lieutenant Colonel Jacques Dextraz, declared, "In the event the battalion is attacked, there will be no withdrawal, no platoons overrun, and no panics." During the battle, Leo commanded a unit of around 18 men, repelling whole Chinese divisions while enduring heavy artillery and mortar barrages for 3 days. Even though Leo had been ordered to retreat when the Chinese divisions counterattacked, he refused. Instead, he demanded that the commander of the mortar platoon, Captain Charlie Forbes, rain mortar fire on the enemy. The mortar fire was so close to Leo's position that the commander could hear the bombs explode when Leo spoke on his radio. And it was so intense that the mortar barrels warped from their rate of fire. Leo was awarded another distinguished conduct.
I mean, that's how close they was to getting close to them. Mm-hmm. Like, they had to bomb them right there, like, type of energy. You know what I'm saying?
Medal for capturing and holding the Key Hill. Leo is the only Canadian to win the Distinguished Conduct Medal in two separate wars. He lived a quiet life afterwards and in 2008, at the age of 87, passed away, having been married for 57 years and having four children.
That's beautiful.
Made his family proud.
Wow.
All right, you guys, I'm going to stop it right there. This dude's story is one unheard of.
For real?
100%.
Going through that town, first of all, what shocked me the most was that it's one person
mm-hmm.
marching in whole troops to the alley lines. Like,
numbers.
Yes.
Not 10.
At one time, numbers. 90. Yeah. Over 90 people.
Mm-hmm.
Child, they saw something in him. Okay. So, we hope you guys enjoyed learning about this with us. Like this video, subscribe, turn on the post notification bell. We have enabled our
super thanks.
If you'd like to support the channel that way, as well as our reaction request form is in our description box below. We'll see you soon.
Peace.